Welcome to Marking the End Times. I'm Mark Hitchcock. I want to thank you for joining me for this program. What I want to talk to you about today is Zionism, the word Zionism or a Zionist. We hear this word being used a lot today by enemies of Israel. We hear Hamas calling the people of Israel today Zionist occupiers. We hear Iran referring to Israel as Zionists. So what does the word Zionist mean? And what does the word Christian Zionist mean? I'm a Christian Zionist, and I want to explain to you what a Zionist is, what a Christian Zionist is, and what is our basis for being a Christian Zionist. So I want to talk about that on today's program, a very important issue, I believe, today. And before we do that, I want to mention some questions we're going to answer a bit. We'll go into our subscriber-only section here in a little bit and to answer some really good questions. One question is, should we expect to see the Gog-Magog war before the rapture? Is that the war that will lead to the peace treaty between Antichrist and Israel? So a great question about the timing of the Gog-Magog invasion. Another question, I believe that Enoch and Elijah are the two witnesses, this writer says, and where are they now and in what form have they been in since leaving? And also another question about the mark of the beast and how the number 666 fits into that. And then a final question about a view of the timing of the rapture called the partial rapture view. So I want to talk about that partial rapture and does that have any validity in the New Testament? So we'll get to those questions here in a bit. But as I said, I want to talk about this word Zionist or Zionism, because the word Zionist is really a new word that's being used. It's not a new term, but it's a new term for Israel's enemies that they use now, I believe, to justify their anti-Semitism. So instead of Iran saying they're against Israel or they're against the Jews, they use the word Zionist. You know, we're against the Zionist regime. And I think this is being used by them often to camouflage their anti-Semitism. And so them being anti-Zionists and hating Zionists and all that is really just a new word for really an old hatred. It's a new word for their anti-Semitism. Now, I want to talk a little bit about Zionism and where it comes from, because we hear that word, and really the idea of being a Zionist is that you're advancing or you hold to the idea that Israel has a right to their national homeland, that the Jewish people have a right to their ancient homeland in the Middle East. Now, there's been kind of Zionist movements throughout church history, but as far as the modern Zionist movement really got great traction back in the late 1800s with Theodor Herzl. You go to Israel today, you see his name everywhere, Herzl. He's really the father of modern Zionism, began in the late 1800s. Now, you talk about where's the word Zion come from? Well, Zion is one of the hills or mountains in Jerusalem. There are several mountains and small hills there, or kind of small mountains that make up the land there around the city of Jerusalem. And Mount Zion is really where the city of David is today, just south of the Temple Mount. You see it there from the Mount of Olives when you go to Israel today. But it's often used in the Bible, Zion is, as just a synonym for Jerusalem or even a synonym for the nation as a whole. So Theodor Herzl begins this Zionist movement to have the homeland of the Jewish people restored to them, really in the late 1800s. Well, then Christian Zionism comes along, and the term Christian Zionist came into being in really the mid 20th century. About 70 or 80 years ago. Before that, it was known as Christian Restorationism, and it really began in England back in the 1600s. There were groups of people who believed that the Jewish people had a right to their ancient homeland to be restored there. But of course, 1948 was a key for Zionists and certainly for Christian Zionists, because as Christian Zionists, we believe that was a fulfillment of Bible prophecy, that was a super sign of the end times. So as a Christian Zionist, I believe that Israel, the Jewish people, have a right to their ancient homeland in the Middle East. I believe that Israel has a future in God's plan. God has a future for Israel. And I believe that 1948 was a fulfillment of Bible prophecy, setting the stage for what lies ahead. Now, being a Christian Zionist doesn't mean that we have a blind endorsement of everything that Israel does. You know, we give approval to everything the nation of Israel does. But it does mean that we believe that Israel has a right to a secure homeland, to live in that homeland that was given to them by God. And my belief and my stand as a Christian Zionist is based on the Bible. And it's based on a lot of things, but primarily on a covenant that God made with Abraham and his descendants 4,000 years ago. This covenant that God made with Abraham is known as the Abrahamic covenant. Now, I wanted to go back into Genesis just for a little bit, and you can get your Bible either now or at some other time and look this up. But in Genesis chapter 12, God gives Abram a promise. And he comes to him and says, "The Lord said to Abram, go forth from your country, from your relatives and from your father's house to the land I will show you. And I will make you a great nation. I will bless you. I'll make your name great." Now, I think that's an individual promise God gives to Abraham to make his name great. But then there's a corporate promise or a national promise that he says, "I'll bless those who bless you, and the one who curses you, I must curse." So this is the promise here, and really a threat that God gives, that those who will bless Abraham and his descendants will be blessed, but the one who curses them, God must curse. Now notice God tells Abraham, go from your country, go from your relatives, and leave your father's house. Well, Abram, when he leaves Ur of the Chaldees down near Babylon, he fulfills the first prong of these conditions. He left his country. He was going to a land that God would show him that he'd never seen before. And then he goes, remember, and pauses for a little bit in the area of Haran, up north of Israel. But when he leaves, he takes his father with him and all of his relatives. So he doesn't fulfill what God said. When he gets up to Haran, his father Terah dies. So he leaves his father's house, but he takes his relative Lot with him to go down into the land. So he's fulfilled two of the prongs. He left the land. Now he's left his father's house. But finally, you remember that because of a conflict between Lot's herdsmen and Abram's herdsmen, they split. They part ways. And at that point, Abram then has fulfilled all three of these prongs. He's left his country. He's left his father. And he's left his relatives behind. And God then comes to him in chapter 13, near the end of the chapter. And the Lord God said to him, notice it says, after Lot separated from him, "Lift up your eyes, look from the place where you are, northward, southward, eastward, westward. For all the land which you see, I will give to you and your descendants." And he adds this word, "forever. And I will make your descendants as the dust of the earth. And if anyone can number the dust of the earth, then your descendants can be numbered. Arise, walk about the land through its length and breadth, for I will give it to you." And Abraham moved his tent and came and dwelt by the oaks of Mamre, which are in Hebron, and there he built an altar to the Lord. So God promises Abraham here, Abraham, you've left your land, you've left your relatives, you've left your father's house. I'm going to give you as far as you can see in every direction. I'm going to give you this land. I'm going to give it to you forever. When you get to chapter 15, God memorializes what he promised there and makes a covenant with Abraham. It's a blood covenant. So what happens is God comes to Abram and he says, "Abram, get these animals, three different animals, and cut them in half and throw one of the carcass on this side and another carcass here and make a pathway between." And he also has some birds that he kills, but he doesn't divide the birds in two, just these three animals, these three large animals. And places their carcass there where a pathway between. And what would happen in that day when a blood covenant was made, the word covenant means to cut. When a covenant was cut, both of the parties would walk between the pieces of those dead animals to show that if they violate their word and what they promised, may they be like those animals. In other words, they were promising their life. So Abram places these animals there and he falls asleep. And when he wakes up, he sees a smoking oven and a flaming torch. It's a theophany. It's a visible appearance of God. And he sees this smoking oven, this flaming torch walking between the carcasses of those animals. And so Abram doesn't ever walk between them. So this covenant is a unilateral covenant. Nothing depended on Abram. In fact, he just woke up from being asleep. Everything depended on God. It's a unilateral covenant, and it's an eternal covenant. God says it's forever, and it's also an unconditional covenant. There's no conditions placed on it. And God promises in this land, promises Abraham three main things. He promises him seed or descendants. He promises him soil or land, and he promises salvation through the one who will ultimately come through Abraham's line, the Messiah, who will bring salvation. So he promises those three things. Those are kind of the three prongs of this covenant, soil, seed, and salvation. But when you get down to chapter 15, a little bit farther down, God promises Abraham a specific land that he's going to give to his people. In chapter 13, it was just, you know, look as far as you can in every direction, I'll give that land. But notice in verse 18 of chapter 15 in Genesis, on that day, the Lord made a covenant with Abraham. He said, to your descendants, I have given this land. So the Jewish people have ownership of the land. Now, they've not always occupied it. There's a difference between ownership and occupation. In fact, God himself has put them out of the land on various occasions, but they own the land. So, you know, when people ask the question, who owns that land? It's the descendants of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. I've given your descendants this land from the river of Egypt, as far as the great river, the river Euphrates, the Kenite, the Kenizzite, the Kadmonite, the Hittite, the Perizzite, the Rephaim, the Amorite, the Canaanite, the Girgashites, and the Jebusite. That's the land that God promised. So it's from the river of Egypt to the great river Euphrates. Now, the river of Egypt is not the Nile River, because if it was the Nile River, the children of Israel would have been in the promised land before they ever left Egypt. So it's not the Nile River, but the Nile River, when it gets up into the Delta, you know, the Nile River flows north. It's an unusual river, flows to the north. And up in the Delta of the Nile River, there are different fingers or branches of the Nile. And one of these branches or fingers is the easternmost one of these was known as the River of Egypt. So it's basically kind of along the line of the modern Suez Canal. So God's promising from that River of Egypt, right along where the Suez Canal is today, all the way up to the Euphrates River will be the land that he'll give to Abraham and his descendants forever. Now that includes modern Israel today. All, you know, the what's called the West Bank, what's called the Gaza Strip. It includes most of what is modern day Lebanon. It includes a fairly large portion of modern day Syria, almost up to the city of Damascus, and even a small part of the modern day nation of Iraq. Now, the Jewish people have never inhabited and had control over all of that land at any time in their history. And God promises he'll give it to them. So I believe it'll be in the coming kingdom, in the millennium, when God will fulfill this promise and he'll give them this land. But in the meantime, as a Christian Zionist, I believe that the Jewish people have a right to a homeland there, and that they're part of God's prophetic program, that 1948 was a significant event. Now, what we'll see, you see later if you read through Genesis, is God reiterates this promise to his son Isaac, and then to Isaac's son Jacob. So it's to Isaac, not Ishmael, it's to Jacob, not Esau. It's to Abraham, to Isaac, to Jacob, and to their descendants, the 12 tribes of Israel. Let me read in Joshua 1. You know, when Joshua comes into the land to take the land, in Joshua chapter 1 and verse 3, God says, every place on which the sole of your foot treads, I have given it to you, just as I spoke to Moses. Now listen to verse 4, from the wilderness and this Lebanon, even as far as the great river, the river Euphrates, all the land of the Hittites, as far as the great sea, that would be the Mediterranean, toward the setting of the sun will be your territory. So we hear a lot today about from the river to the sea. Well, here you have not just from the river to the sea, but from the rivers to the sea. He says it's from the great river, the Euphrates. It's all the way down to the river of Egypt. On the west or on the east, it's bound by the Jordan River and goes all the way to the Great Sea. That's what God has promised to the Jewish people. And I believe that as a Christian Zionist, we want the Jewish people to have a land that they can live in and be safe in. They're not going to get all that land until Jesus comes back, their Messiah. And he's going to fulfill this promise, this covenant with Abraham, when they'll have the land that God has given to them. You know, a lot of people will say today, well, the Jewish people are over there in the land and they're not believers in Jesus. You know, they don't trust in the Lord. They have no right to be there. Well, remember when God gave the land to Abraham, he gave the land to Abraham before Abraham trusted in God. It was a gracious gift of God to Abraham and to his descendants. So, based on this promise, you and I should support Israel. We should pray for Israel. Our God is a promise-making, promise-keeping God. And think about this. If God doesn't keep his promise to Abraham, we have no hope that God's going to keep his promises to us. But we see God's brought the Jewish people back there in 1948. He's keeping his promise. He's a promise-making, promise-keeping God. He's faithful. And all the promises of God are yes and amen in Jesus Christ. And the next promise to be fulfilled on God's prophetic program is the rapture. And it will be fulfilled in God's good time. Well, we're going to go into the subscriber-only section now and answer those questions I mentioned earlier. If you're not a subscriber, I would like to be, you can go to endtimes.com and sign up there for $7 a month and become a subscriber. We'd love to have you as part of our fellowship that we gather each week. And there's all kinds of great things online that you can view. It'll really help you to understand the times in which we live. So let's go to the question and answer time now and answer these great questions.